gallant colliers and listen to me tale. How they closed the Aberammon pit in Aberdare, South Wales. It was in 1842 that coal there first was won. She's yielded 40 million tons, but now her days are done.
To close a colliery, especially a pit that's been running for 120 years, is a very big and serious decision to make.
It is contended in some quarters that it's necessary to close Aberammon Colliery to man the neighbouring pits in the valley. But I don't think that this is actually right. I think the real reason is due entirely to exhaustion.
Well, Aberammon Colliery is an old colliery, and, well, it's been working well over 100 years, and so it's quite reasonable to assume now that the resources of coal is exhausted.
There are, in the neighbourhood, a number of developing collieries where productivity is high, pits like Deep Dufferin and Abergorkie, Abercannon and so on, and we felt that by closing Aberammon, where the reserves are very limited indeed, we could provide the necessary experienced manpower to build up these more productive collieries. And so it was agreed with the divisional board that this be done, and the first step in the procedure was to go through the reserves in considerable detail to find out exactly what we had left, and we came to the conclusion that there were no more than about 18 months of productive life left at Aberammon. As production manager, I met the union's mining engineer, went through the reserves at Aberammon, looked at the reserves and possibilities in the neighbouring pits, and just took it from there. The men could certainly have claimed to have run Aberammon on for at least another 18 months. There was coal there which we could have worked, and without great difficulty. But their attitude of mind was such that they accepted the fact that it would be wise to move now.
As nobody have liked it, but of course they have seen the sense in it, that if we had dug our heels in and said we weren't going to go from here, well, eventually we would have been pushed out, and we wouldn't have had the conditions from the coal board, I don't think, anyway, what we've been granted with this closure going in an organised fashion as it does like.
The general manager arranged a meeting in the local workman's hall where we brought along the plans and the reserves of Aberammon and information about the pits to which we wanted to send the men. The men, quite naturally, it always does occur when you have a closure, knew of little reserves of coal which they quite certain would prolong the life of Aberammon. Well, there was a first-rate discussion, and we had very clearly their fears of moving to certain of the pits that we proposed. The fears of the men were primarily, I think, that they were moving to Deep Dufferin, which was a day and night shift calling colliery. Deep Dufferin was a colliery with a capacity considerably in excess of the output which they're achieving at the moment. We needed to do more development, and then we were quite certain that we could absorb this labour from Aberammon. So the first step was to get a small proportion of the men over as quickly as possible to carry out the initial development. And the second stage was to bring in the men to man the first face, and then the final stage was to bring over the last lot of men to man up the final faces. We held further meetings with their mining engineers and with the lodge officials in order to discuss their ideas. They always find a little patch of coal somewhere which their fathers and their grandfathers had told them about in the 2-foot-9 seam up on Tom Williams' district. I can't say that it was agreed in general principle that we would close Aberammon, but what we did agree to do, what we did, I think, convince them of, that the reserves of Aberammon were indeed very limited and that there was a need for men at these highly productive pits. Now, the biggest consideration, obviously, was to get the right type of men into the mechanised faces at Deep Dufferin and wherever else they may be needed. So a combined committee consisting of a deputy production manager, a group manager, one of the industrial relations staff, and the workmen themselves, sat down and went through every man's name in Aberammon Colliery.
It has been the orthodox manner of mining. There has been no power loading in Aberammon Colliery.
In a thin seam, men are working on their knees, and it takes some time after they've come from a thin seam to a thick seam, to acclimatize themselves, not to get down on their knees.
We as lodge officials at the Duffin Colliery, we have discussed it for days at the pit head to try and fix all these people up in these jobs, colliers in their own occupation, cleaners and switchmen.
I've been amazed, as I said, at the detail. A chap is coming down, he's coming to a strange pit, he doesn't even know where to hang his coat really when he starts off. And the more things you can do for him, socially, bus travelling, introduce him to the official, make sure that he's got a locker in the baths, make sure he knows where his lamp is. Every little thing you can do, make him feel at home.
Men of 50 years of age in the mining industry are termed old men and long past their best. But these men can still do a useful job of work.
I lived in a valley 10 miles away, so I know the reaction that this produces in men when you close a colliery and move them 5 or 10 or even 2 miles away. And people are changing their place of work, they're changing their officials, they're changing their workmates to a large extent. And I've seen the effect that this has in Welsh ferries.
We've earned good money here and it's been a happy pit. Well, that's what we're all going to miss, and I'm going from here on Friday along with 134 others as the final transfer. They don't know me down there, I don't know them. But I think once we've got over the teething troubles there, we'll knit together like we have done here at Aberaman.
This, I think, is good, very, very good on the part of the Coal Board that they have been able to keep up the assurances and guarantees that they gave in the first instance. I could not see that happening 30 years ago because I started prior to 1926 general strike as a young boy in the pits. And it is only since the days of nationalization that I have known of measures such as this being taken in this industry.
The essence of the transfer, or the smooth working of it, starts off by producing a card for each man. And on the record card he has got the name of the colliery that he is going to, the shift that he will be working, the time that he is to be at that colliery to sign on, and the appropriate time to meet the manager of each respective colliery.
Well, pits die. This is inevitable, isn't it? The reserves run out and they come to an end, and equally certainly, other pits have to be developed. It's complete uprooting, isn't it? And so it has to be done gently and with consideration.
Farewell to Aberaman Pit, you've served us well, goodbye. The face is dark and empty now, it's silent therein by. The roads we drove will soon close up, and time will take its toll. For pits are born and die, but colliers still must win the coal.